people who aren't heterosexual, people who don't experience sexual attraction, do face discrimination. They do face prejudice. Yeah. And there's lots of proof of that.
Yeah.
And that is one of the main arguments for including these people, because when there is a need for a supportive community for people who experience on some fundamental level discrimination for the way they feel romantic or sexual attraction, or don't, or the way that they experience gender, or don't, then they need a community. There's a need. So there really is kind of a need to include asexual and aromantic people in this community. It really just comes down to whether or not the word queer can be used. And queer is, at this point, using the word queer is more of a symbol. Whether or not you have your queer badge, are you queer? Because a lot of people, again, use the queer community to mean LGBTQIA.
Hello and welcome to the KMX like Octopus podcast. We built this podcast with our own.
What is up? This is Cosmo here.
Along with Tracy.
From the Geometric Octopus
podcast.
We are about to shroud your ears in the greatest conversations you have ever heard.
Or not. That is up for you to decide.
Trigger warnings for this episode include
ostracization,
homophobia,
transphobia,
suicide and self-endangerment,
sexual abuse,
and violence against people of the LGBT community.
So please be a responsible listener.
The array of topics we discuss in this episode is rather wide.
So we hope to revisit some of the material again in another episode.
This is episode 7.
Gatekeeping and a word on Leelah Alcorn.
Congratulations, you are not transphobic.
Yeah.
probably not.
If you've gotten to this point in the episode, you're probably not transphobic because...
explicitly.
Yeah, because, dude, in the first episode, I say, my name's Anne, I say that I'm a girl, I am a trans woman, and I realize that at this point in time, my voice does sound, most of the time... very masculine. And I'm working to correct that. Oh, that's a good thing to kind of jump off onto for a second. Voice changing surgery, vocal surgery, is very difficult because essentially what they do is they stretch or shorten your vocal cords, but they do that while you are unconscious.
Mm-hmm.
So you cannot use them. And it's a bit like trying to tune a musical instrument without listening to it.
Yikes. Yeah. Oh, wow.
Which is very difficult. And for every good thing that comes out of you can also get quite a few kind of horror stories.
You can wake up mute.
Yeah, you can wake up mute. You can wake up sounding like Minnie Mouse.
That's horrifying. Yeah.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to wake up sounding like Minnie Mouse.
I wouldn't want to wake up mute, right? to be quite honest.
That too, yeah. Well, I'd rather wake up sounding like Minnie Mouse than waking up mute.
Yeah.
I want my voice, gosh dang it. I want it. It's a tool that I have to have.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's definitely an advantage
but
in a lot of
the
cases.
The thing is, it's very interesting because that's a surgery that's very often very much needed because your voice is one of the first things that people listen to or think about when they're trying to determine what your gender is. Because everybody tries to determine what your gender is from the moment that they meet you. And that's fun.
Yeah.
But your voice is one of the biggest tells on that. So if you're listening to somebody who talks like I do with a rather deep voice, even when I try to sound my most feminine, I tend to sound like a very stereotypically gay man.
You know what's strange is that I never thought you were gay. Maybe I just don't have like a radar or anything for these things because like,
the proper term is gaydar.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
I don't have a gay radar. A gaydar.
That's the thing. That's a weird term to use a lot of the time because it's like, I've had conversations with my friends who were talking about it. It's like, I picked out another non-binary person at 30 yards across the classroom. I just knew it. And I'm like, is that, that's not gaydar, is it? I don't think that's gaydar. How could you tell?
And
the unfortunate thing is that there actually is some kind of like gender role presentation that for some reason we seem to think of each other as.
Reading between the lines.
Yeah, almost everyone that I've made friends with in the past 4 years has turned out to be queer in some way. And there you're going to have to jump into, there we kind of have to jump into a little bit the issues on terms, because I know there are quite a few people who do not like the term gaydar.
Well, it's, and gaydar's just a, at this point, gaydar's a pun.
Yeah, gaydar's a pun. And personally, I use it to refer to just finding any non-cis, non-straight individual.
Yeah.
And for which, for clarity's sake, when I use the term queer, I realize that in the past it has been used as a derogatory term, but when I use it to refer to non-cis, non-straight people just out of convenience.
Well, do we want to talk about the reclamation of that word? That's a very important part in history.
Oh, definitely, because one of the things is, if you're looking at terms that are derogatory, currently quite a few derogatory terms are being sort of reclaimed by the people groups that they were derogatory terms against.
Because it's 2015!
Well, there's a variety of reasons. When we're talking about slur reclamation, the first thing that, like, the most fundamental thing that we typically say when we start talking about reclaiming slurs, in this case, queer is a slur that's being reclaimed. When we talk about the most typical thing we have to say, first of all, is, like, you can't reclaim a slur unless it can be used against you or has been in the past used against you in a way that was definitely meant to harm you. And
well, if I follow those rules, okay, I have a pretty big list.
That was used against you in a way, like,
if it's a term that is used to describe a basic part of who you are.
There we are. But if someone called you queer, but you're not technically queer, you still can't reclaim the word.
Yeah,
sorry, no,
yeah.
You don't get that card. But, of course, when we're talking about this, there's a very small part of that that I'm just going to note that I want to talk about how we use the word queer and how we gatekeep that real quick. But not right now.
Yeah.
Reclaiming slurs, in this case, this was originally reclaimed by a group of queer activists in, I believe, San Francisco, because we were having, as a community, as an entire mass community, problems saying, like, well, can we include transgender people? Are we including bisexual people in this? Because everything was under the term gay. And
yeah.
that's still kind of the thing when we're talking about, like, the terms gay straight alliance is still used a lot for queer support groups. And these
gay
groups,
rights
course,
movement.
The
is,
gay rights movement.
Which, is used as an overarching thing for everything from marriage equality worldwide to rights, basic human rights for trans people. And
it's technically not supposed to be used that way, but is.
Yeah.
Anyway, so when we were talking about gay being used as an overarching term, that was kind of a problem that was happening at that point in history. And I can't remember the specific year, I'm sorry, but it's complicated for me to remember all these things at the same time. But it was a thing. And so we decided to reclaim the word queer as a community. And the word queer was originally meant to include everyone who was not cisgender, was not... who did not experience same gender attraction. And that's where we come into another issue that's happened in the community recently. And this has really only gotten to the point where when we're talking about reclaiming slurs. And I don't really want to be involved in this conversation because I myself am not asexual or aromantic. And that's the problem.
Hey!
I am. but it's fair to talk about because we're talking about reclaiming slurs.
Oh, yes. Can you please tell the audience the rules of being able to reclaim a slur or a derogatory term, specifically, so they know.
We kind of already covered the fact that, like, you can't... terminology that we use when reclaiming... when talking about reclaiming slurs is really what's gotten us into trouble in this particular case. Because a lot of people define what... the characteristics that you need to be able to reclaim the word queer as being... you either are not cis. If you're not cis, you're queer. Done. Or if you experience... same gender attraction. And attraction is the word we're dealing with. Because when this issue becomes a reclaiming issue, it's typically in the asexual community or the aromantic community. And this has really become a kind of an issue of gatekeeping in a way. In a lot of ways, just a lot of terminology ways, excluding asexual people and aromantic people from using the word queer, because asexual people cannot experience sexual attraction at all. So can asexual people be included in the queer umbrella because they don't experience quote-unquote opposite gender attraction? A lot of people say yes, a lot of people say no. And
and sorry, if I can butt in here for a second. Even more beyond that, there's much more gatekeeping on asexual, on asexual heteroromantic people.
Yes.
And heterosexual aromantic people.
Yes. I'd like to talk about that real quick. Because really, when people are trying to talk about this issue in a gatekeeping manner, people are saying, like, well, we can't include these people because this reason. They're not really referring to, like, say, asexual people who are homoromantic. There's no question that those people are queer because they're experiencing a form of same gender attraction. That's automatically queer. But when we're talking about, say, aromantic asexual people or heterosexual aromantic people or heteromantic asexual people, these are the people that are kind of being targeted by this kind of gatekeeping. And it's hard to say who's right or wrong on this, honestly, because on the one hand, really when we're talking about reclaiming slurs, we're talking about, like, people have to be able to use this word against you. But on the other hand, queer has been reclaimed to a certain point where it doesn't really mean... it doesn't mean same gender attraction, or like, it doesn't mean you have to, like, pull out your queer credentials every single time. It means, are you a part of this community that we're considering to be other?
Yeah. And even beyond that, queer has been a term used for asexual and aromantic people as well. And asexual and aromantic people have kind of been considered, at least by cisgender, heterosexual, heteroromantic people, as, you know, they've kind of been lumped in even back to when people were using the term confirmed bachelor to refer to gay people, which confirmed bachelor was a term that was used. The secondary F word was a term that was used.
So this is why this issue is very specific. This is one of those issues where people would not be able to butt in and ask for clarification because it's an in-community issue.
Yeah.
A lot of the argument against including asexual and aromantic people in the umbrella involves the fact that they are in some way or another straight. And then
they're not.
And
sorry.
Wait, please.
Sorry.
Straight. When we talk, okay, so let's say that an asexual homoromantic person wants to call themselves gay. We can, of course, do that because this person is gay. This person experiences same gender attraction. Boom, done. This person is also automatically queer. However, a lot of the times in this argument, people like to say that heteromantic asexual people aren't straight. But under that argument, then homoromantic asexual people aren't gay. And unfortunately, that's not really something that we can be saying in that sense. We can't be saying that heteromantic asexual people aren't straight, because they are. It's just they're not heterosexual. And that, typically, is the issue that we come up against. Mm-hmm. Because people who aren't heterosexual, people who don't experience sexual attraction, do face discrimination. They do face prejudice. And there's lots of proof of that.
Yeah.
And that is one of the main arguments for including these people, because when there is a need for a supportive community for people who experience on some fundamental level discrimination for the way they feel romantic or sexual attraction, or don't, or the way that they experience gender, or don't, then they need a community. There's a need. So there really is kind of a need to include asexual and aromantic people in this community. It really just comes down to whether or not the word queer can be used. And queer is, at this point, using the word queer is more of a symbol. Whether or not you have your queer badge, are you queer? Because a lot of people, again, use the queer community to mean LGBTQIA. All of them.
I said I and P. Oh, no, and there's, it's LGBTQIAAI.
And you don't need to repeat letters. Letters can stand for more than one thing. And
plus,
there's multiple ones. Just
I know what I meant.
And sorry, I'm just as a whole.
And it's in the same way that we can that there's a difference between saying LGBT and LGBTQ and LGBTQI and LGBTQIA. There's a difference between each of these things. But when we get to a certain point, like I knew what I was definitely meaning, and what I was meaning is the inclusion of the A. That was the point I was trying to make.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to exclude you, pansexuals. I think I'm being very clear that I love you.
Actually, I figure before we move on, I should clarify. I am asexual. I do not experience sexual attraction, but I will probably also talk over the course of this podcast about me experiencing attraction, because I do experience romantic attraction. I am panromantic.
There we are.
Which romantic attraction is very, very different from sexual attraction.
Yes. Ugh, I forgot what I was saying.
LGBTQQIAAP.
That's fair.
Something like that. And that's like, fair. I saw some other ones, and I'm like, I kind of like this one.
Oh, God, whatever you do, don't use Mogai. God.
That's Mogai.
Mogai was marginalized and...
What the hell?
I don't remember.
That sounds bad already.
Something.
Oh, I've seen that.
I can't remember specifically what it was, but I do remember that it includes pedophiles, so we're not whoa. Using that.
Whoa.
Oh, yeah. It was a terrible term, and it was used to refer to... It had something to do with people who are not liked, and I can't...
It was something about marginalized orientations.
Yeah, and it was used and created by people who... included pedophilia as one of those marginalized orientations. So it is not a term that is used.
That's not an orientation.
Yeah. God. It's disgusting.
It's really uncomfortable that we can have the conversation at this point with, like, people legitimately defending the opposite side of this discussion, saying, like, oh, well, like, such and such reason. For such and such reason, pedophiles are discriminated against. Is that, yeah, you're discriminated against because you target children.
They're discriminated desire. Against because they deserve to be discriminated against.
I feel like this deserves its own section, so we'll come talk about this some other time.
Mm.
Have you seen the new things in Germany where there is now help for pedophiles or who experience extreme attraction towards youth, and they can get counseling to find ways to work around it?
You see, that is a fair reaction to pedophilia.
I know, and I saw that. I'm like, oh, wait, does this mean I don't have to hate people now?
Well, when we talk about pedophilia, it really stems into a whole series of issues regarding...
Well, I mean, we assume that pedophiles are going to act on every urge they have. Yeah, I mean, it's been conditioned that way through media and movies. Man, I can tell you how many times there's, like, pedophilia in movies, and it's stressed that all pedophiles are, like, these old beer gut guys who want to, like, jump on 9-year-olds and stuff like that, and it's just, like...
It's not just... It's glorified in a lot of cases. Yeah. That's what we're talking about. Let's talk about the sexualization of the female body, quote-unquote.
Oh, yeah.
Quote-unquote. There's a very specific film I'm thinking of right now, and it's not Lolita, although I do... need to mention, Lolita is a prime example of this. It was, is American Beauty?
I don't know. I know.
Remember, we covered that in that film course. Very briefly.
I do not like Nabokov, and I do not like the fact that he is considered to be one of the great authors. I mean, I kind of understand it, because Lolita was not intended, it was intended to be, in a sense... somewhat satire, because it goes to the point of just complete extremes of something so horrible that... But I know people who have read that book and have thought that it was a love story, which is horrifying, because it's a 40-year-old man and a 9 to 12-year-old girl.
Ow. This specific book is problematic in the sense, not that the way it's intention... the way it was intended to be written necessarily, and that really is, in a lot of cases, an issue that's up to debate for literature majors and such. This is a big topic of discussion a lot of times. This book in itself is problematic because people read it and it's normalized. Now, this has become something that they now are familiar with and have some sort of sense that it's acceptable, because it's this glorified book that, like, almost everyone knows exists and is one of the great books ever written. And really, it's just a major part of a much larger system of the sexualization of young girls. And that's something that's hard to talk about in a lot of senses, because it's something that's so ingrained into our understanding of society, the idea that it's attractive for a woman to be thin and hairless and young-looking, and there's an entire subgenre of pornography that caters to the fetish of pedophilia, that this is just an accepted part of our lives.
It's the part that makes me want to kill myself all the time.
When will I die? When will I leave this earth?
That's pretty much, that's like my motto, or my repeated mantra, but...
But we can't leave the earth, so we have to deal with it and hope.
Gosh, dang it, don't shatter my dreams.
You can't leave the earth, I'm sorry. You have to deal with things as they exist, because abandoning is just as bad.
Which is the only thing that keeps me on the tightrope. Anyways.
Yeah. But,
In my eyes, indisposed, in disguise, is no one knows. Hides the face, lies the snake and the sun. In my disgrace, boiling heat, summer stench, neath the black the sky looks dead. Call my name through the cream, and I'll hear you scream again. Black hole sun, won't you come and wash away the rain? Black hole sun, won't you come, won't you come, won't you come? Stuttering, cold and damp, still the warm wind, tired friend. Times are gone for honest men, and sometimes far too long for snakes. In my shoes, walking sleep, and my youth I pray to keep. Heaven sent, hell away. No one sings like you anymore. Black hole sun, won't you come and wash away the rain? Black hole sun, won't you come, won't you come? Black hole sun, won't you come and wash away the rain? Black hole sun, won't you come, won't you come? Black hole sun, black hole sun, won't you come? Black hole sun, black hole sun, won't you come? Black hole sun.
In the case of films like Lolita, books like Lolita, and the fact that we know that there's this subgenre of pornography and there's this entire group of people who are, this is their kink, then this is, we as a society can condemn, like, okay, pedophilia is wrong. We can typically as a society, like, say that without a whole hell of a lot of backlash.
Oh, yeah.
However, when there are actual cases of pedophilia, and this can include young women, this can include young men, this is, can include young gender divergent people, it doesn't matter because they're kids. It really does not matter. You victimize the child. That is the end of your position in society. You have harmed someone.
Yeah.
Really, there shouldn't be any debate. But as soon as these kind of things happen, that there's an understanding as part of a community that someone has committed an act of pedophilia, there's often a lot of denial. And there's a lot of people who want to defend that person because they know that person. They feel protective of that person. So when we can condemn as a society pedophilia, but then as soon as we have an instance of it, we can try and move away from it. We can try to ignore it. We can try to say that that probably wasn't what happened. We can try to deny the experiences of traumatized children. Then we have a problem.
And if I may, even beyond that, something else that happens is that quite often these people are, even if it's not denied, these people are excused.
Absolutely.
And it's said, no, it was okay. And that goes into a conversation that I feel would be much better suited for another episode, because this episode is supposed to be focused on LGBT issues, and that would be an episode on a much different and much darker topic, which does have some tie-ins to LGBT issues, because it is something that does happen to LGBT individuals. But I feel as if it would be better covered in another video.
We're almost obligated to talk about it in some senses, though, because...
True.
There's, of course, a stigma that especially gay men are stigmatized as being pedophiles, and there's really no reason for that. Because of the victimization of young boys by grown men, that's where that stigma kind of comes from, despite the fact that there's basically an equal amount of people who victimize, like, men who victimize young girls. Yeah. There isn't an actual basis for that stigma, so that's why it's kind of inappropriate to make jokes about. It's like, there was something going around when the rainbow filters were on Facebook, that, like, someone made some kind of, like, fake Uber facts thing that was like, did you know local law now requires that pedophiles have a rainbow filter over their Facebook photo, which is not to mention...
What the hell?
Completely inappropriate humor. It's just absolutely inappropriate.
I'd curse, but I don't have the strength to.
It's not only completely inappropriate humor because you're making light of pedophilia, it's also completely inappropriate because it's in some ways perpetuating the idea that gay people, especially gay men, are pedophiles.
I believe that that was the author's intention.
It was being shared a lot by people who were like thinking of it as a joke, and I got involved in a discussion about that at the time because I was very angry that people I knew were making this kind of humor.
I'd be like, pissed off if I saw that. What
is wrong with you? Why do you think this is funny?
I would have been pissed off.
Oh, absolutely.
It's like, on the one hand, it's just like, I can't believe this freaking happened, and I'm very upset, and I'm going to get in a fight, and I'm so insulted that I even know you. But then on the other hand, I'm like, wow, I'm so glad that this thing happened, so I know how to take out the trash now.
Yeah, but...
Let's take now, out the trash.
Before we get much further, what I was going to say is this definitely leads into a discussion about forced sexual encounters.
Yes, absolutely.
And that was why I was saying it's probably much better if we leave the larger discussion on that for another episode.
Yes, I have no intention of going into the larger issue of CSA.
Yeah.
Is there anything else you'd like to cover up in the terms of an advice for transgender individuals? Or
actually, I did, when reviewing our recordings from last week, notice that I said I was going to talk about Leelah Alcorn and then I didn't. And I'm still kind of like, self, you should have done that.
Okay, we can talk about Leelah Alcorn.
Talk about, well, not quick, but let's focus on Leelah Alcorn. And then I also, let's wrap up with a happy message, for goodness sakes. Let's try to make
it gets better.
Yeah.
Can we not with let's get better? Yeah, oh that, my God.
It gets better.
Yes, but that... it's associated with that particular group.
It seems, group and like Tracy was said, it seems disingenuous as well.
Yeah.
So many people have told me that in random times, in random places, and it's just like, why do I find that so offensive?
It's my favorite.
It feels condescending.
Yes.
Because saying that, like, saying it gets better, it feels condescending because you're saying it's like, whatever you're feeling in the present doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It's like, well, thanks for nothing. Thanks for absolutely nothing. Bye-bye now, Dan Savage. Because earlier in the sessions from last week, I did at some point mention that I would talk about Leelah Alcorn, and this up till now I have not talked about Leelah Alcorn, and I feel kind of obligated to talk about her now, especially considering that I was sort of advertising The Lost Generation earlier, because that was one of my major theses that I've ever written about. And just in fairness to Leelah and everything that happened to her and around her, she is an important part of queer history, and especially transgender history. Leelah Alcorn was a young transgender girl, and she committed suicide. That normally is the end of the story for young transgender people who commit suicide, and that's really unfortunate because, as many people know, but maybe also many people don't know, that the rate of suicide in the transgender community, especially among youth, is incredibly high. Nearly half for among youth, and that makes Leelah sort of a statistic. But the difference between what happened with Leelah and what happened with everyone else who died before and after her is that Leelah made a suicide note. She wrote a suicide note to be posted after her death on her blog, and in her suicide note, she spoke out against what happened in her family, from her parents, at her school, with her personally, and she more or less stated that she killed herself because her family did not accept her, and she didn't feel like she had a future. And she wanted her death to be a message that this can't be allowed to happen anymore. Leelah also spoke about how she went through conversion therapy, not transgender conversion therapy, but gay conversion therapy, because her family not only denied her gender identity, they also thought that she was possibly gay. And that is something that happens to transgender people a lot. So, really, what happened with Leelah could have ended there, except her suicide note went viral. Everything that happened to her, everything that happened around her, her entire family now was in the spotlight for a long period of months. Leelah kind of became, in some sense, a martyr for the transgender youth community. of what was happening to transgender youth, of what could happen to transgender youth, about what could happen to your child if you have a transgender child. Your child can be Leelah Alcorn if you don't treat your child with the respect that they need as a transgender person. So there was, of course, a large period of public outcry, including, for once in his life, an actual sign of support from Dan Savage, which I only feel obligated to mention because I threw shade at him earlier. So, like, congratulations, Dan Savage, you occasionally do things right. Really, when we talk about Leelah now, we're talking about conversion therapy, because that was what happened to her, and that was what everyone in the wake of her death decided, like, the best thing we could possibly do in the wake of Leelah Alcorn's death would be to ban one of the most traumatic things that happened to her. Because for some reason, conversion therapy is legal. And I do believe you mentioned that earlier, but we just need to really emphasize that, that's an incredibly traumatizing experience, and it is legal to perform on any minor without their consent.
Yeah.
So, really,
it's a form of legal torture.
It is a form of legal torture, because it's psychological torture. Sometimes it's physical torture. And what happened to Leelah can never happen again morally. We as a society cannot say that it is acceptable for a child to go through this kind of traumatic experience and kill themselves as a result. Because that's what happens to transgender youth. We can't deal with the situations we're in because they're so awful and there's no hope and there's no light. And it doesn't really always get better. Because transgender youth not only have to go through their first, like, going through the first 18 years of their life sometimes with being denied by their families and being abused by their families, going through conversion therapies against their will. These things can happen. These things do happen. And then, well, people are sometimes telling these kids, like, well, everything's going to be better when you're 18. Everything's going to be over. You can move out. Transgender people can't do that all the time. No one can escape that. People in abusive situations are not always free to escape them. And in this case, when we're talking about transgender people, these people, even if they escape this kind of abusive situation at home, are going out into society that is still awful, that will still treat them like crap, that will still abuse them, can kill them. You can get murdered just because of who you are. And that's not an exclusive issue to the transgender community, but this is what we're talking about right now in this moment, because sometimes it does not get better. When we're in that kind of situation, when people are in the situation, especially as young teenagers, suicide is what happens. And that's not acceptable. That's not a situation where we cannot do anything when we have the power to do something that can help. Banning transgender conversion therapy would be one of the greatest things that could come of Leelah Alcorn's death. And it hasn't happened.
Yeah. It's almost been a year.
Yeah. And by my memory, the statistic is about half of all transgender youth will attempt suicide before their 20th birthday.
Absolutely.
And that's absolutely horrible.
It's socially unacceptable. It's not something we as a society can say is okay. And it's not a victim-blaming kind of situation where we're saying, like, well, people just shouldn't commit suicide. No, that's not how suicide works. There are a variety of factors that tie into whether or not someone is a suicide risk. But at this point, being transgender is a massive risk just because you are transgender. And it's not the fact that you are transgender. It's the fact that because you are transgender, people are treating you differently.
It's the way that society treats you that that drives you to that sort of thought process, which is not good, definitely. And if you look into the future, at the very least in years past, many transgender youth have not had anyone to look up to. They've not had anybody that they could see in popular media. They've not had any representation. They don't know what life is going to be after after high school and they think it's going to be the same. And it's definitely not perfect after high school. Definitely.
Definitely not.
But once you're no longer... If you have parents who are anti-transgender, once you're out of their house, it can get a lot better and a lot easier.
Absolutely, yeah. I think that is a message we need to like be sending at this point, is even if things don't always get perfect, and if, as a society, we're not building a situation where we can, where people can feel completely comfortable leaving their home lives.
Yeah, and it will not get perfect, but it
will improve.
It's definitely, and that's not to say that what you're feeling now doesn't matter, because it absolutely does, but it will improve, because it has to. You just need to find people who support you, and that can be really difficult. Maybe you won't be able to find them in high school, but you will be able to find them in college. You will be able to find them once you're outside of college. You will be able to live as who you are, not as who other people see you. And it's getting better in the outside world, definitely.
In the interest of ending on a happy note, and of course, getting better is a really happy note, honestly.
Yeah,
it's what can keep you alive in a lot of cases. But when, just to follow up on conversion therapy and such, I would like to mention that in the wake of Leelah Alcorn's death, there have been, even though we cannot at this point on a statewide level ban conversion therapy across, like, there are, I believe, 2 states that have banned conversion therapy. Here in Washington, there is now a ban on foster children and wards of the state in general who are youth, who are transgender or gay, going into conversion therapy. It's no longer legal, and if you at any point find yourself as a ward of the state in Washington state, you will never go into conversion therapy. That you are now safe in that sense. And this is really due to the work of several activists, including people from Stonewall Youth in Olympia. They're amazing people.
Oh yeah.
They've done great work. They're a great community resource, not only for Olympia, but throughout the state. And really, I think things are improving, especially here and across the country, and hopefully across the world. And
I can say it's definitely improving up in Canada.
A resident Canadian.
Hey. And yeah, it is definitely improving up in Canada. And it's thankfully, with the way that Canada works, it's improving kind of across the board rather than, I mean, it is improving province by province, but in many ways it's improving kind of across the board. I believe the sort of bathroom bills have been struck down, the ones that the former prime minister was attempting to kind of push through.
Those were...
Yeah.
Yeah.
And those still go on in the United States. Bathroom bills being laws that don't allow transgender people to use the proper public restrooms, which leads to massive amounts of violence, which is... We were going to end on a happy note.
Let's were! And...
Maybe God,
it's so difficult to talk about things that aren't going downhill.
Yeah.
Laverne Cox is amazing. There's our happy note. Yeah. Laverne Cox, goddess on earth.
I was going to say that too. Okay. I didn't want to jump the gun, but
yeah, she's and that's a prime example of transgender representation in the media. She's a trans woman who is a very, very famous actress now.
And that's absolutely amazing, because that means that transgender girls have someone to, you know, someone that they can see in the media who is like them, and they can know that, no, they're not, there's nothing wrong with them for being trans.
That's really the role of representation, is normalization.
Yeah, it's that, it's so that you know that there is nothing wrong with you. You are who you are, and nobody can change that. And that's amazing.
That's amazing.
You are amazing.
You are amazing. You are amazing. You are
amazing. Tracy and I would like to posit that not all pedophiles are molesters. There is a difference between those who act on their urges and those who do not.
And we hope to cover that another time. Anne Boudois, Cosmo Cavanaugh, Kyle Mitchell,
Tracy Medcalf, and our featured guest, Cosmic Kendry, poured our hearts,
or what's left of them,
into these recordings for you.
So take your sweet time in savoring them. Send your questions, comments, or contributions to geometricoctopus@gmail.com.
If you have any personal stories on gender and sexuality,
any at all,
please share them with us.
Now go away.
But not permanently.
Fine, fine. So come back for our next episode where we tear each other apart with pitchforks.
Yay! Thanks for listening. Won't you come? Black hole sun, won't you come? And wash away the rain. Black hole sun, won't you come? Won't you come? Black hole sun, black hole sun, won't you come? Black hole sun, black hole sun, won't you come? Black hole sun, black hole sun, won't you come?